So welcome once again. Today we'll continue with the intelligent agents that we were talking about last time. And hopefully we should be done with that soon and then get into our main discussion today, which is on problem solving. Okay. So let's continue about the intelligent agents. Just a small note here. Generally, when you see a slide which has an R written at the back, I hope you can see that, it indicates that this is a review slide. Okay. So generally, in the beginning of the lectures, I do have some review slides. So this was the agents and environment that we already spoke about last time. I'm not going to go into the details of that. We spoke about the structure of intelligent agents. I realized that in my slide last time, there was a small typo. For P, it said percepts, when it should have been performance. And then we spoke about the four types of agents, starting from the simple reflex agent to the model-based agent, and then the model goal-based agent, or simply goal-based agent. And then we spoke about the utility agent. Okay, so we'll continue from where we left. And now what we're going to talk about is what is referred to as a general learning agent. Okay, and you can think about as all of machine learning is essentially about a general learning agent. Okay, so my question to you now is, how does one actually learn? If you think about it, how are you learning in this course? Hopefully you're learning. How did you learn as an infant or a child? How does one learn? What's the key ingredients when it comes to learning? You're exposed to some information and essentially that you learn from that, okay? That's fine, but what's a key component of learning? Practice, did you say? And? Patterns, okay. Memorization, okay. So basically, memorization is good, but perhaps not the best way to learn. Making connections, okay. So when you learn different concepts, you start relating those two. So forming relationships is very important. That's very good. So experiential learning, as we say, when you, for example, if you worked in the industry and you come back and do your MBA, then you're learning from experience. Okay, very good. Observing patterns. Okay, so all of that is fine, but I'm looking for a key component of learning, which all of your responses are mostly fine, but there's a key component which I'm looking for.
Experiences.
Okay. What happens when you do an exam or a quiz? Or you ask me a question, like I'm asking questions right now. What's going on right now?
Testing, right.
So basically I'm testing your knowledge, I'm asking you questions, you're responding, and then what am I doing? You're communicating with me, but generally, let's say you give me a wrong answer or you give me a right answer, what do? I say that's the right answer, so I give you, what do I give you? I give you feedback, right? So feedback is a very critical component of learning. So whenever you get feedback, that's the time when actually a lot of the learning comes. And that's why it's very critical for in any course or whenever you're in a learning environment for you to ask questions, okay? It's when you ask questions and the instructor or whoever is responding to you gives you feedback, and then they either confirm what you're saying or they say, no, that's not the right answer. Okay. That's when a lot of learning comes in. Okay. So feedback is a very critical component of learning. So if you think about how does one learn as a child, the first time when a child makes a mistake, right, put the hand in the fire on something hot, then what happens? they get some kind of a feedback from the environment, right? And that feedback is compared to the perhaps the optimal feedback, optimal situation. Well, the optimal situation for the child is everything is gung-ho, right? There's no problems in life. But as soon as that negative feedback comes, then that's very painful. So the child is comparing the feedback that they got with the ideal situation. And the ideal situation is no pain. And when they did get pain, the child compared the two. And then what did they do? What would they next do? They would make a decision and what would the decision be? Learn that. Should they do it again, that activity? Hopefully not, right? Children are sometimes tough learners. They keep on doing mistakes until, even as adults, we keep on making the same mistakes twice. But hopefully, every time we figure out that the ideal response is different from what we're getting, we compare those two and we say, well, we've got something to learn. So we correct our mistakes, okay? So that's the feedback that is very critical to learning, okay? And if you look at the next slide over here, basically, this is talking about that particular feedback. So here is the performance standard. This is what I'm saying is when the child is thinking everything is fine, that's the performance standard. Everything should be perfectly fine. There should be no pain, at least. Okay. The environment, sometimes you do an action. Okay. You take an action and you get feedback, and that feedback is not very pleasant. Okay. And that feedback is then compared. So the feedback comes in over here, and the feedback is compared to your current, what you're currently doing, okay? And then you try to make a change, okay? So here the change hopefully is a change in your action. So next time you will not perform, if the same environment appears again, you will hopefully not take the same action, okay? So this is essentially what learning is all about. And you will see this if you take a course, and as we go through machine learning, you'll see that, for example, if we're trying to understand an image, okay? And we see an image, and if you remember, we spoke about Google Photos, okay? So Google Photos was learning at some point. What was it asking you? It was asking you that it thought that two images looked similar. And so it wanted to confirm from you whether those two images were actually the same person or not, okay? So what was it doing? It was looking at the knowledge that it had was that these two images are the same, okay? And then you as the critic said, yes, they're the same, in which case it would be a positive feedback and it would say that these two images are the same and I'm learning, I'm reinforcing my learning. Or you would say, no, these two images are actually of different people, okay? In that case, what would happen is that the performance element, which was everything that we spoke about earlier, would basically be corrected. You understand that these two images, that there's something wrong with these images, right? Maybe and if it was a self-captioning, for example, the caption said a man in a blue shirt, whereas in fact it was a man in a black shirt. Well, the correct answer, so the label that would come in over here, the performance standard would come in and say, no, the label correct answer is it's a man in a black shirt. Okay, and that correction would then go into this element over here, and it would correct the future responses. Okay, so this is where the learning is coming in. Now, besides this feedback, what else do you see over here? Does this remind you of something that goes on in classes, at least in most classes at IBA? How do we do problem generation? Maybe it's too early, but sometimes in the middle of the semester, you will be given quizzes, believe me, right? And so we give you problems, okay? And when we give you problems, we're giving you new problems. So we might have hopefully taught you some scenarios, but we might give you a new scenario and we'll say, can you figure this one out, okay? So it might be a new photograph. For example, you might, if you have existing photographs and you've been able to figure out what the difference between a human and, let's say, an automobile, but all of a sudden you want to see whether that system is really learning, and you give it an image of maybe a zebra or maybe of a truck, right? And you want to figure out whether the system can actually differentiate between, an automobile versus a human being, okay? So that would be like a new problem. So sometimes, once in a while, you have learning goals and you create new problems, and those problems then test your situation. Okay, they test your learning, and again, there's going to be feedback. Okay, either it's going to be rectified or not. Okay, so this is the general learning agent, and this can be applied to pretty much all of the previous agents that you spoke about. Okay, we'll come back to this agent as you go through this course. Okay, this is not going to be coming in the next few lectures, but as we go to machine learning, we'll come back to this. Okay, so these are the broadly speaking the five agents that we've already spoken about. So now let's try to figure out, remember we spoke about the four things, perform, PEAS. So the next thing that we'd like to speak about is the environment. Okay, now the environment can be of different types. So let's take a look and try to understand the different types. So one type of environment could be a fully observable. Okay, fully observable or partially observable. Hopefully there's nothing like not observable at all. So it's either fully or partially. So now let me ask you, can you give an example in the past cases that we've already spoken about with the two classic situations that I've been asking you, that I've been presenting to you. One is a self-driving car and the other was some kind of a medical diagnosis system, medical system, okay? Either that or use any other example and try to figure out, can you give me an example of what would be an agent where the environment is either fully observable or partially observable? Any thoughts? Okay, so is GPS fully observable or partially? Okay, what do you think? It's fully observable. So in a sense, what is the environment in a GPS? So by GPS, the other day I got a little confused because I'm from a networking background. And when somebody says in a network sense, what is a GPS, I'm thinking about the satellite system, okay? But for an average person, the GPS system simply means what you have on your Google Maps and it's trying to route you. Okay, so let's consider the Google routing mechanism. Is the system, as far as the Google Maps is concerned, does it completely understand the environment that it needs to be able to find out the destination? Does it have everything in the environment? What does it have, by the way? Do you know how it works? So it has the current location and the destination. And what else does it have? How does it find the optimal route? So it's utility based, right? So it's not just doing a route. It's not just saying a goal based. So it's actually a utility based agent. It's trying to find an optimum route. And most of the times, the optimum route is the shortest route, the route which is fastest, okay? So what is it using to find the fastest route? Traffic, right? Primarily it's traffic. So if there's a lot of traffic, it'll use an alternate route. But is that fully observable? Does that really have everything that you need? What else doesn't it have in the environment? Sorry? It doesn't take into account what? The fuel consumption of the car, okay. So yes, it has a lot of other information that is not there, but then again, the question is that relevant or not? If there's a bird flying in the air, that's not relevant. Similarly, the fuel consumption may not be relevant because you're looking for the shortest path. But that's a good point, but it's not really relevant. Okay, G. Sorry? Any new constructions, right? But what about probabilistic scenarios? All of a sudden you're going, and as you're going, it found the route, but within the last minute, there was an accident, right? So you notice that it doesn't have that updates that frequently, right? So it may have an update which is half an hour, an hour ago, but it won't have an instantaneous update. So in that sense, it's not fully observable. Even all the relevant information is not fully observable, okay? So you might say that a GPS system is partially observable, okay? So let's look at some other examples. Can you think of an example where it is fully observable? Perhaps a simple example. Sorry, a self-driving car, okay? Is that fully observable? No, no, a self-driving car is not at all fully observable because imagine the complexities that come in when you are driving, right? Do you know who's going to come around the, you know, your cousin who drives crazily and goes through red lights? Is he going to come across as soon as you're going through the green light, right? Probably, hopefully, if you don't have such a cousin, but there is a possibility that in Pakistan especially, people drive in all kinds of, it's very unpredictable, okay? So you don't really have, the system is not fully observable. What else don't you know? It's a self-driving car, even if the best of cars will have images coming in, okay? They might have a LiDAR, which you spoke about last time. They might have an audio signal, but they probably don't have a very good mechanism to sense the road. You know, if there are ditches in the road, it won't be able to sense that, okay? So certainly a self-driving car is not at all a fully observable system environment. What's a simple example of a fully observable system? Sorry, hospital. Okay, you're picking on very difficult cases. Again, think about it, it's not fully observable, okay? Online trading, I won't agree with that either, because imagine the complexities going on behind online trading, okay? So trading platform, online grading. Okay, so when you're doing online grading, yes, so essentially, yes, that's a good example, because the paper is there, you have the student script, and hopefully everything is there. So that's completely observable, and hopefully it should be. I mean, if I as a teacher was grading you and it was partially observable, you would have a serious problem, because you would say, how can you, you know, grade me if you didn't even look at the entire exam paper? So that's a good example, okay? Chess, is that fully observable or partially observable? Fully observable, right? Because if you're playing against your opponent, obviously the entire chessboard is visible to you, okay? Let's go on. Deterministic. By deterministic, it means that so agent's current state and action completely determines the next state of the environment, okay? So you're in a particular state and you want to go in a particular direction, okay? So you're driving your car, you want to turn right. Will the car always turn right 100% of the time? Or is there some small possibility that it may not turn right? Has anybody driven in a snowstorm or an ice? Does anybody recall when your car doesn't go in the direction? That's happened to me, you know? So your car skids really badly. So what happens over there? You're trying to turn right, you took an action, you turned the wheel right, but that didn't happen. So there's a small probability that it may not happen. What happens is not what you expect, okay? You can think of other examples as well. Again, chess, is that deterministic? If you want to go from point A to point B, that is always happens, okay? Can you think of another example where it's not deterministic besides driving? Any other examples of where it is what in a particular state you take an action and what you're expecting is not what happens? Sorry? Stock market. Okay, so well, stock market, you're expecting that it will go up and you buy, okay, and it goes down. Yeah, so that's a very good example. Stochastic, G. Weather prediction, yeah, you've seen that in Pakistan, right? If they say it's going to be hot, it becomes cold, and vice versa. So those are very good examples of stochastic systems, okay? Episodic versus sequential. So episodic is defined as only the current or recent percept is relevant, okay? So now think about it, this is a little tricky. Is a game of chess episodic or sequential? So only the current or recent percept is relevant, okay? So game of chess is probably sequential, okay? And you look at other examples. Static versus dynamic. Okay, static simply means that the environment doesn't change while you as the agent are thinking. Okay, so imagine in a chess game, is that static or dynamic? Static, definitely, right? As you know, the opponent has played, and now you're thinking. Now, as you're thinking, the chess board does not change. Right? Hopefully it doesn't change. So that's definitely an example. Dynamic, can you give me an example of dynamic system? Sorry? Whether driving again, because as you thinking, as the car, the self-driving car is thinking about what to do, is the system, is the environment changing? It's changing because it's continuously changing, right? So even if it takes a millisecond for it to make a decision, in that millisecond, there are some changes in the system, okay? Discrete versus continuous. Is the environment in the self-driving car, is the environment discrete or continuous? It's continuous, right? Because, you know, the shades of everything, people are walking, everything is continuous, okay? Is chess discrete or continuous? Chess is discrete because you have specific positions, right? And you can clearly say that this is what the chess board is. You can't have a pawn half in between two moves, okay? A single agent or multi-agent? So we saw an example of that. Rock, paper, scissors, people said, example, right? That is multi-agent. Chess, single agent or multi-agent? Multi-agent because you have an opponent, right? What's an example of a single agent? Truth or false, yeah. People played solitaire, for example. You can play against the computer. Hopefully the system is considered not as an agent. In that case, you're single agent, okay? So those are some of the examples of the environment. So here, the same examples. I think we've got most of these over here. So multi-agent, for example, football games, chess, all of these are multi-agent games. Okay. Solitaire, single agent, because the agent is considered the person who's playing. Okay. You're playing against an environment. So if you think that the environment is the computer against which you're playing, then it's single agent. If you think that the computer itself is another agent, then it will become multi-agent. Okay, so it depends on how you define it. But generally, I would consider it as a single agent game, okay? Because then the question is, what do you consider as the environment? So the computer, the program can be considered as the environment, okay? But again, it can be a little fuzzy at times as to how you're defining it, okay? G. Space invaders, yeah. So again, you're playing against the computer, okay? And you're the agent, and you're playing against the computer. So that would be a single agent again, okay? If it's a multiplayer game, then it will become multi-agent. Definitely it will be a multi-agent, okay? So that talks about the environment. The next thing that I'm going to talk about is now let's take a look at the agent, okay? Now, going back to the agent, if you look at when we spoke about the structure of an agent, remember we said that here's an agent program, okay? This goes back to our first slide. Now, this is essentially your AI program, which is based on the percepts that it's getting from the environment. We've talked about the environment, the different types of environments, and the percepts that it's getting. Now the agent program is the real brains, okay? This has to decide what actions to take, okay? So if you're trying to play a game of chess, you have to decide if the computer itself is playing against another person, then the computer has to decide what moves to make, okay? So now in the agent program, you need to model the environment as well, okay? So you could model the environment in a very simplistic way. So for example, if you think about the chess game, how would you model a chess game? Okay, so think about, you're trying to model, or let's think about a simpler example, a very simplistic version of a self-driving car, okay? And some of you might have actually, I remember one of my student groups tried to create a self-driving car, okay? What they did was they took some actual photographs, okay? And this was in the final FYP project. And they made lanes, okay? And they tried to make the car intelligent enough to be able to decide whether the lane was going straight, going to the right, going to the left, or there was a stop sign, okay? And they were reasonably successful at that. It would take pictures and based on an ML algorithm, it would actually learn how to make these decisions. Okay. Now, suppose that you try to create, this is your environment. Okay. Your environment is the car is what you're trying to design, and the environment is outside. Okay. It's actually the boards, the lanes, and so on. Okay. The signal. Now, how would you model the car? Can you think of a way that you could model the car? All you're trying to do is trying to either do one of four things. Either take right turn, okay? Take left. In other words, you're going to be moving at a constant speed. You're either going to take right turn, left turn, keep going straight, or stop, okay? There's no other things that you want really your car to do because it's very simplistic, okay? So how would you model the car? How would you go about modeling the car internally? What would be if you think about the states, okay, the states of the car, what would be the states that you would think about that the car can actually possess? And I've already given you the hint. So there would be four states, right? You would model the car as either going straight, stopped, going left, or going right, okay? And if you did an action, suppose you took an action of going right, and then the environment observed that the car was moving right, you would have a confirmation that yes, the car did turn right, okay? And the perception that you get is that yes, the car did turn right. Now, what happens if it's stochastic, right? You try to turn right, and what happened quite often is that the car wouldn't go right, okay? Simply because there's so many factors, right? Maybe the engine died or it turned left by mistake or something other happened. So in that case, you tried to turn right, but you actually observed that it was going it stopped, okay? The battery died. So what would the percepts tell you? What would be the actual state of the car? It would say that the car is actually stopped. You try to go right, but the car actually is in a stopped position, okay? And then you would take some actions to try to maybe restart the car or something, okay? So you can think about the way you're making a very simple model of the real world. Is the real world that simple? Is it really four states? What did I just tell you? What happened to the car? The battery, right? I said that the battery could have actually died. So did we model the battery in this simple case? No, right? So all we did was we made a very simple assumptions, and we made a simple model of the car, of the actual environment. Now, what's the pros and cons? We could have modeled the car in a lot more detail. What we could have done is we could have said that the car actually has batteries. Okay, what else could we have thought of in the car? There's a petrol perhaps. Well, in this case, it's a battery powered car, but in the real car, it would actually have it would have a certain amount of gas or petrol, it would have a battery to start it off, you know. Sorry? Tires could burst out, so it has tires which have to be in good condition. So all of this, the real world is a lot more complex, okay? But a lot of times when we try to do something simple, we try to make a very simple model of the real world, okay? And this you'll see every time. Every time you want to do something, and you want to program, you will try to model you start with a very simple model, okay? And this goes on all the way. If you're doing in a PhD, you will have to make a very simple model of the world, okay? Because the real world is far too complex. Even if you're trying to do a stock prediction, you'll have to make some simple assumptions about the stock market so that you can actually make some predictions. If you try to make a very complex model, you know, your AI engine will just go crazy, okay? G. Right, so the environment, remember we said that we also modeling the environment as being very simple, okay? It's either saying a right, the road is turning towards the right, road is going straight, road is turning to the left, or there's a red light, okay? But now you're saying that somebody could actually jump into the middle of the road. So what is that doing? That's saying that you're making a more complex model of the environment. And that's the real world again. So when you start off, you need to make some very simple assumptions. You see if your AI, your model actually works in those four scenarios, then what do you do? Then your instructor will tell you, okay, in phase two, you do the more complex things, right? But you start off something simple, okay? So going forward, so in the real world, this is what you're doing. You can actually have what is called an atomic representation of the environment, okay? The atomic example was where each one of them is discrete, okay? It's not continuous, it's very simple. For example, the four states of the car, okay? Stopped, turning left, turning right, going forward, okay, that's it. A more complex, a factored, the example that we talked about, where you actually, inside the car, you have a battery, okay? Inside the car, you have tires, as you spoke about, okay? You have a lot of other factors. That becomes a more complex model that's a more complex model of the environment that the agent is making internally, okay? So remember, this is an internal model of the environment of the agent, okay? This is all inside the agent's mind. So the agent can be thinking that the model, that the environment is very simple, which is the first case, atomic case, okay? It could make a more complex model, which is the factored version, okay? Now you can even have a more complex model. So here are the examples. So for example, in the patient case, the simple example would be that you could say that the patient is either healthy or unhealthy, right? But patient comes to doctor and he says, well, doctor makes a decision and your Watson computer program decides that either he's healthy or unhealthy. Very simple, too simple perhaps, okay? A factored example would be that you would include the attributes. What exactly do you mean by healthy? Okay, what exactly do you mean by unhealthy? Okay, so you would say, well, the patient has temperature, they have a blood pressure, they have glucose, they have cholesterol. All of that actually determines whether the patient is healthy or unhealthy, okay? So that's a factored representation of the environment that the agent is making, okay? Now you could have an even more complex. So this is what is referred to as a structured representation, okay? The structured representation is saying that not only am I making, do I have certain attributes to whether a patient is healthy or unhealthy, but now I'm saying that a patient actually is far more complex, okay? It has certain objects within it. For example, if they have heart, lungs, kidneys, and so on, okay? And they have relationships between them, okay? So for example, if somebody has COVID, then the respiratory system is being affected. If the respiratory system is affected, what happens to your circulatory system? Okay, your circulatory system is definitely affected because your oxygen is not going into your blood, okay? If your kidney if your liver starts failing, probably, I'm not a doctor, so I can't say, but there are probably 10 other organs inside your body which are impacted, okay? So you could have a relationship model between those. Now you can imagine that that's becoming very complex, okay? So the agent could have three kinds of models: an atomic, very simple, a factored, more complex, and a structured, which is far more complex, okay? Now, all of AI today, all right, can actually be modeled by this. And here, I'm showing you, and these are, sorry, I wasn't supposed to show you that. So I want you to, now think about the car. Let's just spend a few more minutes on this. So as far as the car is concerned, what would be an example of an atomic representation? The four cases that we've already seen, right? What would be an example of the factored case? We've already seen that, which is having all of these additional features, right? And in terms of the structured, it would be, for example, give me an example of a structured as far as the car, the self-driving car is concerned. What would be a structured representation of a car, of a self-driving car? Sorry? Okay, no, but that's not in the, sorry? Spontaneous decision. So the self-driving car, it's trying to model the environment. So in the self-driving car, what is the agent? The agent is the AI, which is actually making the decision as to in which direction to go, okay? The environment is everything outside of the car, okay? Or you can think as the environment as everything outside of the AI software, okay? Now, if you want to make a structured understanding of the environment, what we're trying to do is we're trying to say that there are certain objects which have relationships, okay? So what objects outside of the AI software have got relationships? Ji. Okay, so traffic light has a relationship with what? With, give me another object. You have to give me two objects which have a relationship. With the brake. No. You see, the brake is an action that you're taking, okay? It's not a relationship of two objects in the environment. Sorry? Cars, different parts. Okay, that's, give me example of two parts of a car which are related to each other. The carburetor and the engine, right? So I'm not a mechanic, very good mechanic either, but let's take a more simple example. Gee. Yeah, but that's a different example. You're talking about an environment which is not deterministic. You've gone into that. So what we're talking about right now, specifically, given make a structured representation of the environment. And a structured representation basically means that your environment is everything outside of your software, which is trying to control the car. It could be the car itself. It could be everything outside, right? And what we're saying is in a structure, they have relationships. Just like I said, in a human body, in a patient, this respiratory system is linked, has a relationship with the circulatory system, okay? So give me example of two things in the self-driving car environment, which are related to each other. Traffic lights and brake lights of which car? Of your own car? No, you're controlling the brake lights. No, but you see, that is a result of your own action. When you look at the environment, you're looking at the environment as it is. So in the current environment, what are two things which are related to each other? G.
Sir?
When a collision occurs, the airbag opens up, yes. So that's a good example because those are two things in the environment. The airbag can be thought of as part of the environment, and the collision, which is outside, can be thought of as part of the environment. So when a collision happens, automatically the airbag goes up, okay? So those are two things inside the environment which are related to each other. So you could actually have inside, if you created an agent, you could have a relationship between those two. You would actually have a structured representation. You would say, I'm going to model the airbag. In addition to the four things about the car, I would also model the airbag. I would also model accident situations. And if one of them happens, then the other will happen. If I'm going, I'll also need the speed, by the way, because if you're going at 5 miles per hour, the airbag won't blow up, right? But if you're going at, let's say, 60 miles per hour, and you need the speed environment as well, then, and if you have all of a sudden an accident happens, which means you're going from 60 miles per hour to, let's say, 0 miles per hour, then those two things are related to this, to the airbag, okay? Give another example, because I think this point is not very clear yet. The current speed and the distance from the object, right? So essentially what we're saying is that if you're going very fast, then the distance from the object will become smaller and smaller, especially if it's like a static object, it's a tree or something, then those two are definitely related, right? So that's again a good and simple example. Okay, other examples. Yeah. Yeah, very good. So there's a relationship between the footpath lights. So if all of a sudden you have a red light, then you're going to expect that people are going to start walking. So those are two things in the environment which are related to each other. So if you want to have a smart agent, you would actually model both the traffic light and humans crossing, and you would try to find a relationship between them. Okay. Now, everything that we're going to talk about in the next, probably in the next several lectures, is going to be very far from it. Okay, when we get into advanced topics, and let me give you an idea of where the, so these are some of the examples that I spoke about. So for example, the speed, acceleration, weight, those are examples of that we've already seen. These are some examples of, you know, for example, if the car battery dies, then the engine will probably not start. Okay, so there are again examples. So this gives you an overview of the entire course. Okay, the simple cases where we're modeling the environment in an atomic way are going to be covered in all of these chapters, chapters 3 to 5, and even in Markov decision processes in chapter 17. You don't know what an MDP is right now, but in case you're wondering, then that's going to have an atomic, a discrete view of the world. Okay. Factored representations are going to be coming in several chapters. For example, constraint satisfaction problem that we'll talk about all of these, propositional logic, planning, Bayesian networks, machine learning. So for example, in machine learning, which is very popular, when, for example, you're modeling, you're trying to figure out whether this is a human being or an automobile. Okay, go back to that example. So are we making a simple model of a human being, or is it factored, or is it structured? I've already given you a hint that machine learning mostly is factored. Can you try to figure out, well, you don't really know machine learning yet, so perhaps this question is too ambitious. But just to give you an idea, when in a machine learning environment, when it tries to learn whether a human being is, well, when an image is either a human being or an automobile, is trying to decide between those two categories, then it looks at, for example, the image, and it tries to figure out in the neural network, it tries to figure out, is there a face there? Okay, are there ears? Is there a nose? Is there a body? Is there limbs? Okay, if all of that is there, then it's probably a human being, right? If there are wheels, if there's an antenna, if there's glass and so on, then it's most likely an automobile, right? So based on that, you can see that, is it an atomic view of the world, or is that a factored view, a representation of the environment, or is that structured? Are you convinced that is actually factored? Okay, because actually trying to figure out whether a face was there or not, and it has certain probability. Okay, we'll come back to this as we go into machine learning, but this is a little bit of a preview as to what goes on in ML algorithms. Okay. And then most of things like first order logic, expert systems, for example, all of expert systems rely on a much more structured view of the world. Okay, so there you actually try to determine the cause and effect. Okay, if you have a very sophisticated model of the world, or if you have, you know, you're trying to have a medical diagnosis system, you can imagine that it would have some kind of a structure. You would actually try to figure out what are the relationships between different diseases, okay? If somebody has, COVID, you've diagnosed it, well, or let's say if somebody is not able to smell, figure out that smell of different things, then most likely they have COVID, okay? So those are examples of maybe an expert system. And you can imagine that you would have a structured relationship over there, a structured representation of the environment, okay? So that sort of gives you an overview of this course as well. And now next, what we're going to do is this completes the part that we were talking about. And now what we're going to the next part, which is problem solving, okay? And this is now going to make things a little bit more interesting, okay? So let's try to figure out what problem solving is all about, okay? Now, there are various chapters In fact, most of this course is about problem solving, okay? And if you look at the book, section two, so there are several sections in the book. Section two of the book has primarily four sections. There's a simple case, which is a problem solving agent, which is chapter three, which is what we're going to be discussing in today's and probably in the coming lectures. And there are going to be more complex situations where you're going to have adversarial problems, for example, where you have two adversaries, you're competing in against somebody else, or if you have more complex problems. But we'll discuss those as we go forward, okay? So the most simple case that we're going to talk about is what is referred to as a problem-solving agent, okay? Now, a problem-solving agent, as you can imagine, is trying to solve a particular problem, okay? And if you're trying to solve a particular problem, generally you have a certain goal, okay? You're trying to, for example, if you're playing a game of chess, you're trying to win, okay? And so on. So it is an example of a goal-based reflex agent. Okay, remember, which one was that? We studied five different types of reflex of agents, right? So the third agent, which was goal-based, is essentially what problem-solving agents are all about. Okay, and as we look at examples, this thing will become a little bit more clear. Now, in this particular scenario, we're going to make a model of the environment. Okay, and we're trying to, as this is the first example, we'll make a simple simple model of the environment. Okay, now if you remember, the environment could be in one of different types. Okay, so we're going to look at the simpler cases. So, fully observable or partially observable, we'll assume that it is fully observable. Okay. Deterministic or stochastic, again, deterministic is the simple case, and the stochastic case will come in later. Static or dynamic, we'll make again the example, the assumption that the environment is static, okay? Discrete or continuous, which is the easier one? Naturally discrete, okay? Single agent or multiple agents, we'll go with single agent. So these are all the assumptions that we're going to make in the first scenario, which is basically your chapter three that we're talking about, okay? In addition, we're going to make internally the agent has three options, right? The atomic representation, the factored representation, or the structured. Which was the simplest? Naturally, the atomic case, okay? So we're going to have an atomic representation of the system, okay? So those are the assumptions that we're going to make when we're looking at a particular class of problem-solving agents, okay? So this, if you remember, this is a look back at the problem-solving agent. This is what we looked at last time. Remember, in the problem-solving agent, we had an environment, okay? So here was the environment. We had sensors, of course, we had actuators. And remember, it was a little complex, okay? It had a goal, okay? So when you try to solve a particular problem, obviously we want to have a goal, okay? If you don't have a goal and you're wandering aimlessly on the road, then obviously you're not trying to find problem. You're not trying to solve a problem. If you're going from point A to B and you have a goal, then that's what you're trying to achieve, okay? So all of those cases are problem-based, problem-solving cases. Now let's take, and this is perhaps the simplest example that I could think of a problem-solving agent, okay? So think of an environment where you have a mouse, okay? A small mouse, not a rat. It's inside a cage because big rats scare a lot of people. So a small mouse, it's inside a cage with three rooms, okay? These are the three rooms. And there are partitions, the mouse can go between these rooms, okay? So it can go between from room one to room two, from room two to room three, from room three to room one, and vice versa, okay? Now, what are the percepts over here? The percept is basically, as if you think about the actions first, the actions that the mouse can take are, it can either go clockwise or anti-clockwise, okay? To make it simple, there's only two ways. If it's going from room one and it goes clockwise, it goes to room two. If it takes another step clockwise direction, it goes to room three, and so on, okay? So what we're showing over here on the right side, and let me see if I can move this to the top. Okay. So you can see that the states, the internal states, can be thought of as three atomic states, which are again representations of the environment. Okay. So these three states, S1, S2, and S3, would be an atomic representation of the environment. Now, is it an exact representation of the environment? Is the environment fully observable, partially observable? Is it an exact representation? Are the things in the environment that we haven't modeled? It's fully observable in the sense that if we are representing the environment with these three states, then the environment is fully observable, because the environment, the percepts, can maybe an image or something that can tell us where the mouse is. Okay, so it's fully observable. But just thinking back to the environment, have we made any modeling assumptions in the environment? What kind of modeling assumptions have we made? Right, so you can think that the mouse, it can't sort of break through these over here, right? And for example, the other thing is that the mouse could be, for example, in the middle, okay? So those are assumptions of the states. We can't have a mouse which is in the corner over here, okay? So we're making a simple model of the environment. We're saying that the mouse can either be in one of three states, okay? So that's an example of modeling, okay? Again, are the actions, are there any possible other actions that could have been possible that we haven't taken into consideration? Ji? Exactly. So the mouse can run around, it stays there. Okay. So we are assuming that the mouse will be moving, and every time that we look at the environment, the percepts, it will have moved from one to the other. If it was staying in one place, how would this, and this is, by the way, called the state space graph. Okay. So this, the state space graph, has the three states, all the possible states. Okay. It has a graph. Okay. The graph basically represents the links or the actions that are taken. Okay. So in each one of these states, you can take one of two actions. Okay. You can take clockwise, you can go move clockwise, or you can move anti-clockwise. Okay. If you're moving clockwise, you're going from S1 to S2. If you're going anti-clockwise from state S1, you're going to state S3. Kind of obvious. But let's say that I wanted to make it more complex, and I said, give the mouse the option to stay in the same room. So how would you change the state space to be able to include that action? So we could loop around, okay? So we could say that you could stay, and the third action could be stop, okay? So it's not doing anything. It's just stopping over here, and you would have three loops over here, in which case basically you would say that the state space graph has been slightly expanded based on what actions we can consider, okay? And a path is simply a path of possible movements, right? So for example, the mouse could go from S1 to S2, right? And then it could go back to S1. It doesn't have to keep on going in a circle, right? So it could go from S1 to S2, then it could come back to S1, and then maybe goes anti-clockwise and goes to S3, and then it goes to S2, and so on. So that's one realization where a particular mouse is actually going around, okay? So now, so far we've described the environment, we've described the actions, we've described the state space, okay? But have we set the goal? Have we defined the problem? Okay, we haven't done that yet, okay? So if you want to convert this into a problem-solving agent, then we've got to go next and define. We've got to do what is referred to as the problem formulation. Okay, the problem formulation, as you can imagine, says that where do you want to get to? Okay, what's your goal state? Okay, what's your destination? If you're going from your home to your main campus, IBA, that's your destination, right? But you also need to know where you're starting from. Are you at the city campus, or at your home, at home, or wherever? Okay, so you need to know your initial state. What are the possible actions that you can take that we've already talked about? Okay, Then also the transition. So what kind of transitions happen? So if you're in a particular state and you take a certain action, what happens? Okay, where do you go? Okay, which you've already spoken about. So as you can see from this state space graph, we've already defined the transition model. Okay, because we know from state S1, you're going clockwise, you take the action clockwise, you go to state S2. Okay. And then very importantly, you probably also need to know what is the path cost, right? So if you're going with the GPS example, and you're trying to optimize it, okay, you need to know what is the cost going from point A to point B, right? So if you're going through Sadar or if you're going through Lyari Expressway, there are different costs involved. Each one of them has a certain distance, right? And there's a certain time involvement. So if you're breaking the problem down, you need to have certain costs involved in each step, okay? So now let's convert this into a problem. So I'm going to convert this into a problem, and I'm going to say that the initial state is S1. So I'm going to start off at this initial state, and I'm going to say that the goal state is over here, okay? S3 is your goal, okay? Let's assume that there's a piece of cheese over there where the mouse wants to get at, okay? The rest of it is pretty much the same. And we're going to make an assumption that the cost is one for every time you move, okay? So now the problem has been formulated, okay? Now the question is, how do we get a solution? Now, obviously in this simple example, the solution is very simple, all right? But let's look at the general case, and we're going to refer to this as a searching solution, okay? It's a searching problem. And you're going to, what is referred to as a search tree, you're going to formulate a search tree, okay? Search tree is different from a state space graph, okay? Now, what is a search tree? Search tree is going to start off from the initial state that you were in, and then you can do different actions, okay? You could go anti-clockwise. So you could go anti-clockwise, in which case you get to the destination immediately. Okay, you get to the goal state, and there's something also called a goal test, okay? So the goal test, basically what you're saying is very simple. You're saying that, is your current state the goal state, okay? So if your current state that you are in is a goal state, then obviously you got to your goal, okay? If you take a clockwise action, then you end up in state S2, right? Now from S2, you could again take two different paths, okay? If you go anti-clockwise, you end up again in state S1, okay? That's not very smart, right? Because you just came from S1 and you're going back to S1. If you went clockwise again, you would get to your destination, and that the problem is solved. But what happens if you take this particular path? You take clockwise and then anti-clockwise and then clockwise and then anti-clockwise and then clockwise and so on. You have a sort of a loop, okay? This mouse is not very smart. It's going, you know, it's going around in a loop. So in that case, the search tree is infinite. Okay, it keeps on going over and over and over again, okay? So you can imagine that the search tree, even in this very simple case, can be infinite. Now, how would you avoid going through an infinite loop over here? How would you avoid having a search tree which has an infinite depth? What kind, you know, if you're writing an algorithm, what would you do? What would you add in here?
You would store the...
It would only go in one direction. Okay, that's one solution. So what you're saying is that it would only go in a clockwise direction. So that way, in this particular example, yes, it would solve the problem. But is that a generalizable rule of thumb that you would only go in one particular direction? Can you generalize that?
Sir?
Gee, somebody online?
Sir, shouldn't you have like a memory of the states you've already visited?
Memory of the states where you've already visited. Okay, very good. Because if you've already coming from state S1 and you've gone to S2, now next time you want to go to a new state and you've already gone there, you don't want to go there anymore. Okay, because you've already explored that. So if you're in S2, and this particular action is taking you to S1, you're going to compare the destination with And you've got to keep track of which states. So that's making the agent more complex, right? The internal representation, because now you not only have to figure out what the current state is, but you now have to keep track of all the states that you have visited in the past. But that is the correct answer, okay? So by having a set of all the possible states where you have visited in your memory, then you can make sure that you're not going inside an infinite loop, okay? That's a generalizable solution, okay? So let's take a look at an example where we are implementing this solution. So we're having a search tree without repetition. In other words, we're going to make sure that we don't go into an infinite loop. We are going to avoid going through states where we've already visited, okay? In that case, the search tree becomes very trivial in this case, right? Either you take an anti-clockwise step action and you end up in the destination immediately, or you take a clockwise. You're not going to take an anti-clockwise here because you're going to end up in the state which you've already visited. Here you're going, so you're only left with another clockwise step and you're going to get to the destination. So the tree, the depth of the tree, so this is the referred to as the depth of the tree. So the depth of the tree is two, okay? You might say two or three depending on how you're calculating, but let's say the depth of the tree is two, okay? There's also something called a branching factor, okay? A branching factor is in each state, what's the maximum possible destinations that you could go to, okay? If you've only got two actions, then clearly the branching factor is B is equal to two, okay? And the maximum depth in this particular case is M is equal to two. So M is going to refer to the maximum depth that you can go to, okay? So this is about as simple a problem that you can think of. I couldn't think of any problem that is simpler, okay? Now let's take a look at a slightly more complex example, okay? And this is referred to as an 8 puzzle or 15 puzzle or 16 puzzle or 32 puzzle. And there are different versions of this. So in the 8 puzzle, what you have is 8 possible states, okay? 8 tiles which are numbered. And then you have a blank tile, okay? So that's the 9th tile, okay? And now what you can do is, what do you think are the possible actions? And here's the goal state. So the goal state is that you want to have all of these numbered, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, okay? So you want to be able to get all those tiles nicely numbered in a particular order, okay? And you want the blank tile to be over here. Now, can you imagine the possible actions are quite obvious, right? You can make the blank tile either move left, right, up or down, okay? So if you move the blank tile up over here, for example, then 2 would come here and the blank tile would go up, okay? And so on. So you can think of this as something like a Rubik's cube or something similar to that, okay? Now, this looks relatively simple, but can somebody guess what are the possible number of states? Okay, in the previous case, what were the possible number of states? It's clearly 3, right? There's only 3 states that you could go to. What are the possible states, the atomic states that you could have in this, okay? And hopefully all of you have studied some probability or have been exposed to that. So what would be the number of states? Can you guess, G? 9 states, okay? Well, that's one answer. Any other answers?
81.
Factorial, okay. So there's big difference, there's 9 versus 9 factorial, okay? So 9 factorial, how did you get 9 factorial? Okay, so in this particular position, you can have one of 9 possible things here. You can have 1 se lekar ke 8 tak, and then you could also have a blank tile over here, okay? So the 9 possible things that you could have here. Now the next one, you can't have the first one, right? So you're only left with 8 possible things, okay? 8 possible numbers. And so on. So the total number of combinations is in fact 9 factorial, okay? However, interestingly, the number of solvable states. There are some states that are not solvable, okay? And if you read, there's a paper on this, if you read, there are actually some states which won't get you to the destination. And if you know the answer, then this comes out to be 9 factorial divided by 2. How you got this, don't ask me, I don't know, but I read this, okay? So the number of solvable states are 9 factorial divided by 2. And 9 factorial is a pretty large number. It's something like, I think, 18,000 or something, okay? We're assuming that the path cost for each step is 1, okay? So every time you make a move, you have a cost of 1, okay? Now, what do you think, what are we trying to solve here? What would be our objective, okay? So 9 factorial divided by 2 is, 181,000 states. Now imagine how, if you were trying to solve this using the simple case that we saw earlier, it's just not possible, right? I mean, you could keep on trying it, there would be 181,000 possible states, okay? And you could try it randomly. It could take you quite a while to solve this problem, okay? Sort of like trying to solve the Rubik's Cube, but there at least you have some kind of, as they call a heuristic, which gives you an idea that are you getting close to the destination. Here it's completely blind search, okay? So the first thing we're going to try to do is what is referred to as a blind search, okay? So if you think about it, a search, if you convert this to a search problem, then we start off over here and there are 4 possible actions that we could take. The blank tile could go left, right, up or down. And if we're doing the left, what would be the configuration over here? Can people tell me what this would be? This would be the 7, 7, 2, 4. So this would be blank, and then the 5 would come here, and clearly the rest of them would be the same, right? And so on. So this is what we're doing. Now, the branching factor B over here is what? B is equal to 4, because you could possibly branch out into 4 directions. Now, what's the branching factor over here? Is it 4 again? Is it 4 again? Can you move in all directions from this state? It's 3, right? Which state can't you go, which direction can't you go into? You can't go into left. So this state, this is not there, right? So you have only 3. So in all of these, you have only actually 3, because in this particular case, if you look at this, from here, you can't go right. Okay, so this doesn't exist and so on. So the branching factor can change. But normally B is referred to as the maximum branching factor. So in some cases you would again come back to 4. So B is going to be referred to as 4. So this is the complexity of the problem. And now the question is, how do we actually solve this problem? Okay. And how do we go about even trying to solve this problem? So you saw the tree. And the issue is that we could try to do some kind of a search on that tree, okay? What kind of a search would you try to do? Ji. Okay, so first of all, that's a very good idea that you want to implement a tree search in which there are no loops. In other words, you want to make sure that remembering the states, but now remember how many states do you possibly have? 181,000 possible states. So your memory would become quite clogged. So you would need to have 181,000 memory states, which is still possible. I mean, but of course, if you look at larger problems, so here's larger problems. So if you have a 15 puzzle, the number of states grows, almost exponentially. 10 to the power 12. If you have a 24 puzzle, then you have 10 to the power 25 possible states. So you can imagine that keeping track of the number of states that you've been to may become impossible, okay? So that, in some cases that may be okay, in some cases it may not be okay, okay? Any other thoughts? How would you actually try to solve this problem, Ji? So say that again, I didn't quite follow.
So pieces in place of the
Okay, so good thought. So what you're saying is that if any one of these pieces are already in place, okay, so is there any place, a piece in place? So for example, 2 is already in place, 6 is already in place. I think those are the only 2 which are already in place, right? And what your suggestion is that let's fix those, let's not move those. Will that work? That's not going to work, all right? Unfortunately, if you try to solve the Rubik's Cube, you know that you have to go into areas which, if you make this fixed, then actually you're limiting your state space, okay? And you won't be able to reach certain states simply because these become a stumbling block in your state, okay? The other possible ways. Okay, so another possibility is that we try to set intermediate goals, which is try to say, okay, let's try to achieve this particular path, this particular line, okay? Which is what a lot of people do in Rubik's Cube as well. You try to get a certain set correctly, okay? And then you say, okay, once you've done this, then we can tackle the second problem and then we can tackle the third problem. That's a good idea, okay? So you sort of forming what is, this is referred to as a heuristic. You're trying to get an approximate solution and you don't really know if it will work, but you have an idea that, well, if 1, 2, and 3 are in the right place, then we're probably getting closer to the end, solution, right? To the goal. It's a rule of thumb. Does that always work? You think that having 1, 2, 3 in the right place and then trying to work with the rest of it, will that always work? Doesn't always work, okay? In some cases, you may actually realize, and if you think about a puzzle, okay? So if you think about a Pac-Man game, right? And you know that in puzzles, you have all kinds of difficulties. And you, if you're trying to get from here to, let's say, to the destination over here, then the shortest, the heuristic would be how far, this is, let's say, the goal. You're saying, how far am I from the goal, okay? If I'm physically closer to it, I'm probably getting close to the goal, right? But does that work in this puzzle? If you, when you're trying to follow this particular path, you're getting closer and closer, but here, what is the problem? Here, there's a dead end over here, okay? So because of the dead end, sometimes you have to go in the opposite direction, okay? You have to go in the opposite direction to get to the solution. Okay, so the heuristic, the model that we have of the world, trying to see how far we're getting, doesn't always work. Okay, so you could try different solutions, but a systematic way would be what is referred to as doing a tree search. Okay, and we're out of time right now, but this is just a look at what we'll talk about next time. We'll talk about what is called, referred to as an uninformed search, where we're not going to have a heuristic, we're going to do a blind search, and we're going to go through that tree, okay? And we'll talk about different mechanisms to be able to search through that tree, okay? And what are the pros and cons, and which method is better than the other, okay?